हेलो गाइस, योर ऑडियो बुक वाला अगेन बैक विद अ न्यू चैप्टर ऑफ अ बुक, हाउ टू विन फ्रेंड्स एंड इन्फ्लुएंस पीपल, रिटन बाय डेल कार्नेगी। एंड द नेम ऑफ दिस चैप्टर इज ही हु कैन डू दिस हैज़ द होल वर्ल्ड विद हिम एंड ही हु कैन नॉट वॉक अ लोनली वे। आई ऑफन वेंट फिशिंग अप इन अ मैन During the summer, personally, I were very fond of strawberries and creams. But I have found that, for some strange reason, fish prefer worms. So when I went fishing, I did not think about what I wanted. I thought about what they wanted. And I did not bait the hook with strawberries and cream. Rather, I dangled a worm or a grasshopper in front of the fish and said, "Wouldn't you like to have that?" Why not use the same common sense when fishing for people? That is what Lloyd George, Great Britain's Prime Minister during World War I, did when someone asked him how to manage to stay in power after other wartime leaders, Wilson, Arnaldo, and had forgotten. He replied that if his staying on top might be attributed to any one thing, it would be to his having learned that it was necessary to bait the hook to suit the fish. Why take about what we wanted? That is childish, absurd. Of course, you are interested in what you want. You are internally interested in it, but no one else. The rest of us are just like you, and we are interested in what we want. So the only way on earth to influence other people is to talk about what they want and show them how to get it. Remember that tomorrow when you are trying to get somebody to do something, if for example you do not want your children to smoke, don't preach at them. Don't talk about what you want, but show them that cigarette may keep them from making the basketball team or winning a 100-yard dash. This is a good thing to remember regardless of whether you are dealing with the children or calves of chimpanzees. For example, one day Ralph Waldo Emerson and his son tried to get calf into the barn. But they made the common mistake of thinking only of what they wanted. Emerson pushed and his son pulled. But calf was doing just what they are doing. He was thinking only what he wanted. And so he stiffened his leg and stubbornly refused to leave the pasture. The Irish housemaid saw this predicament and she could not write essays and books, but on the occasion at least she had more horse sense or calf sense than Emerson had, and she thought of what the calf wanted. So she put her maternal finger on the calf's mouth and let the calf suck her finger, and she gently led him into the barren. Every act you have ever performed since the day you were born was performed because you wanted something. How about time you gave a large contribution to the Red Cross? Yes, this is no exception to the rule. You gave the Red Cross the donation because you wanted to lend a helping hand. You wanted to do a beautiful, unselfish, divine act. In as much as you done it onto one of the least of these my brethren, ye had done into me. If you had not wanted that feeling more than you wanted your money, you would not have made the contribution. Of course, you might have made the contribution because you were ashamed to refuse or because a customer asked you to do it. But one thing is certain, you made the contribution because you wanted something. Harry A. Overstreet, in his illuminating book Influencing Human Behavior, said acting springs out of what we fundamentally desire, and the best piece of advice which he can be given to the world: be persuader, whether in business or in the home or in the school or in the politics. First arrows in the other person an eager want, and he who can do this his whole world with him. He who cannot walk a lonely way. Andrew Carnegie, a poverty-stricken Scotch lad, had started to work on 20 cent an hour, finally gave away 365 million. Learned early in life that the only way to influence people is to talk in terms of what the other person wants. He attended school only 4 years, yet he learned how to handle to illustrate, his sister-in-law was worried sick over her two boys, and they were at Yale, and they were so busy with their own affairs that they neglect to write home and paid no attention whatever to their mother's frantic letters. The Carnegie offered to the beggar $100 that he could not get an answer by written mail. Without even asking for it, someone called his bat, and so he wrote his nephews a chatty letter mentioning casually in a postscript that he was sending each one a $5 bill. He neglected, however, to enclose the money. Back came replies by written mail thanking dear Uncle Andrew for his kind note, and you can finish the sentence yourself. Another example of persuading comes from Stan Novak of Cleveland, Ohio, a participant in our course. Stan came home from work one evening to find his youngest son, Tim, kicking and screaming on his living room floor, and he was to start kindergarten the next day and was protesting that he would not go. Stan's normal reaction would have been to banish the child to his room and tell him he had just better make his mind to go. He had no choice but to recognize that this would not really help Tim start kindergarten in the best frame of mind. Stan sat down and thought, if I were Tim, why would I be excited about going to the kindergarten? He and his wife made a list of all of his fun things. Tim would be such a finger painting, singing songs, making new friends, and then they put them into the action. We all started finger painting on the kitchen table. My wife, Lil, and my other son, Bob, and myself, and all having fun. Soon, Tim was peeping around the corner. Next, he was beginning to participate. Oh no, you have to go to the kindergarten first to learn how to finger paint. With all the enthusiasm I could muster, I went through the list talking in terms he could understand. Tell him all the fun he would have in kindergarten. The next morning, I thought I was first one up. I went downstairs and found Tim sitting sound asleep in the living room chair. And what are you doing here? I asked. I am waiting to go to the kindergarten. I don't want to be late. The enthusiasm of entire family had aroused in Tim an eager want that no amount of discussion or threat could have possibly accomplished. Tomorrow, you may want to persuade somebody to do something. Before you speak, pause and ask yourself, how can I make this person want to do it? That question will stop us from rushing into a situation headlessly with a futile chatter about our desires. At one time, I re-entered the grand ballroom of a certain New York hotel for 20 nights in each session in order to hold a series of lectures. At the beginning of my one session, I was suddenly informed that I could have to pay almost 3 times as much as rent as formerly. And this news reached me after the tickets had been printed and distributed. All announcement has been made. Naturally, I did not want to pay the increase, but what was the use of talking to the hotel about what I wanted? They were interested only in what they wanted. So as a couple of days later, I went to see the manager, and I was a bit shocked when I got your letter. I said, but I don't blame you at all. If I had been in your position, I should probably have written a similar letter myself. Your duties as the manager of the hotel is to make all the profit possible. If you do not do that, you will be fired, and you ought to be fired. Now, let's take a piece of paper and write down the advantages and disadvantages that will acquire to you if you insist on the increase in rent. Then I took a letterhead and ran a line through a center and headed one column advantages and another column disadvantages. I wrote down under the head advantages these words: ballroom free. Then I went to say, you will have the advantages of having ballroom free to rent for dances, conventions. A big advantage is for affairs like will pay you much more. They get a series of lecture. If I tie your ballroom up for 20 nights during the course of the session, it is sure to mean a loss of very profitable business to you. Now let's consider the disadvantages. First, insist of increasing your income from me, you are going to decrease it. In fact, you going to wipe out, because I cannot pay the rent you are asking, and I shall be forced to hold these lectures at some other place. There another disadvantage is to you, these lectures attract crowds of educated and cultured people to your hotel, and this is a good advertising for you, isn't it? And in fact, if you spend $5,000 advertising in the newspaper, you would not bring as many people to look at your hotel. And I can bring by the lectures, that is the worth of the, a lot of the hotel, isn't it? As I talked, I wrote these two disadvantages under the propping-handed and heading the sheet of the paper of, to the manager, saying, I wish you would carefully consider both the advantages and disadvantages that are going to acquire to you. Then give me your final decision. I received a letter next day informing me that my rent would be increased only 50% instead of 300%. Mind you, I got this reduction without saying a word about what I wanted. I talked all the time about what the other person wanted and how he could get it. Suppose I had done the human natural thing. Suppose I had stormed into his office and said, what do you mean by raising my rent 300%? And why you know that the ticket has been printed and the announcement made? 300%? Ridiculous. I could not pay it. What would you happen then? An argument would have been begun to steam and boil the spitter. And you know how arguments end. Even if I had convinced him that he was strong, his pride could have made it difficult for him to back down and give. Here is one of the best bits to advise ever given about the fine art of human relationship. If there is anyone's secret of success, said Henry Ford, it lies in the ability to get other person's points of view and see things from the person's angle as well as from your own. And this is so good. I want to repeat it. If there is anyone's secret of success, it lies in the ability to get the other person's point of views and see things from the person's angles as well as from your own. And this is so simple, so obvious that anyone out to see the truth of it is gallants. Yet 90% of the people on this earth ignore it 90% of the time. An example, look at a letter came across your desk. Tomorrow morning you will find that most of them violated important canon of common sense. Take this one and a letter written by the head of radio department, an advertising agency with offices scattered across the continent, and this letter was sent to the manager to the local radio station throughout the country, and I have sent the downs in brackets. My reaction was each paragraph. Mr. John Blank, Indian. Dear Mr. Blank, the company desired to retain its position in advertising agency leadership in the radio field. Who cares what your company desires? I am worried about my own problems. The banking is foreclosing, the mortgage on my house, the bugs and destroying of hollyhocks. Stock market tumbled yesterday. I missed the 8:15 this morning. I was not invited to the Jones dance last night. The doctor tells me I have high blood pressure, neuritis, dandruff, and then what happens? I came down to the office morning, opened my mail here in some little whisperer off in New York, yapping about what his company wants. Bah! If he only realized what sort of impression his letter makes, he would get out of advertising business and start manufacturing ship dip. This agency, National Advertising Accounts, were the bulwark of the network. Our subsequent clearness of station time have kept us at the top of the agency year after year. You are big, rich, and right at the top, are you? So what? I do not give two whoops in hates if you are as big as General Motors and General Electric and General Staff of the US Army all combined. If you had much sense as a half-witted hummingbird, you will realize that I am interested in how big I am, not how big you are. All this talk about your enormous success makes me feel small and unimportant. We desire to service our accounts with the last word in radio station information. You unmitigated ash. I am not interested in what you desire and what the President of United States desire. Let me tell you once for all that I am interested in what I desire. And I have not said a word about that yet in the absurd letter of yours. Will you therefore put the company on your preferred list of weekly station information, every single details that will usually to an agency intelligently booking time? Preferred list. You have your nerve. You make me feel insignificant by your big talk about your company and then you ask me to put your preferred list. You did not even say please when you ask it. A prompt acknowledge of this letter give us a latest doing will be actually helpful. You fool. You mail me a cheap form letter and a letter scattered far wide like a autumn leaves and you have to gale to ask me when I am worried about the mortgage of hollyhocks, my blood pressure, to sit down and dictate a personal note, acknowledge your form letter. You are asking me to do promptly. What do you mean promptly? Don't you know I am just as busy as you are? Or at least I like to think I am. And while we are on the subject, who gave you the lordly right to order me around? You say it will be mutually helpful. As last, you had begun to see my viewpoints, but you are vague about what, how to will be my advantage. Very truly yours, John Joe, Manager's Radio Department. The enclosed reprint from the Bay Journal will be interested to you and you may not broadcast it over your station. Finally down is a postscript. You mentioned something the map helped me solve one of my problem. Why don't you begin your letter with but what's the use? Any advertising man who is guilty of attempting such drivel as you sent me as something wrong with his medial oblongate. You do not need a letter giving our latest doings. What do you need is a quart of iodine in your thyroid gland. Now, people who devote their lives to advertising and who pose as expert in the art of influencing people to buy, if they write a letter like that, what can we accept from the butcher and baker of auto mechanic? Here is another letter written by a superintendent of large freight terminal to a student. To quote Edward Williams, what effect did the letter had a man to whom he addresses? Read it. The operation of our outbound rail receiving station are handicapped because a material percentage of total business is delivered to us in a late afternoon. This condition results in coordination over time on a part of our forces, delays to trucks, and in some cases delays to. On November 10, we received from our company a lot of 510 pieces which reached here at 4:20 p.m. We solicit your cooperation towards overcoming the undesirable effect arising from late receipt of freight. May we have asked that on day on which you ship the volume which has received on the above date. Efforts be made either to get the truck here earlier or to deliver as part of the flight during the morning. The advantages that would acquire to you under such an arrangement would be that the more expedition discharges of your trucks and the assurance that your business would go forward on the date of the receipt. Very truly yours. After reading this letter, Mr. Wehrman, sales manager of A. Johnson, sent it to me the following comment. The letter had a reverse effect from that which was intended. The letter begins by describing the terminal difficulties in which we are not interested. Generally speaking, our cooperation is then requested without any thought as to whether it would inconvenience us. And then finally, in the last paragraph, the fact is mentioned that if we do not cooperate, it will mean more expedition discharge of our trucks with the assurance that our freight will go forward on the date of its receipt. In other words, that is in which we most interested mention last and the whole effect on which raising a script antagonious rather than cooperation. Let us see. We cannot write and improve this letter. Let's not waste any time. Talk about our problems as Henry Ford. Gets the other person's point of view and see the things from the other person's angles as well as from your own. And here is one of the way of receiving the letter. It may not be the best way, but it is an improvement. That's bad, but it can be avoided if you make your delivers at the pier of morning when possible. Your trucks will be able to keep moving. Your freight will be immediately attention. Our workers will get home early at night to enjoy a dinner of delicious American noodles at the manufacturer. Anderson, who worked in bank in New York, desired to move to Phoenix, Arizona because of health of her son. Using the principle she had learned in her course, and she wrote a letter. Do you think Mr. Anderson received my response from the letter? 11 of 12 banks invited me to the interview and she had a choice of his bank offer to accept. Why? Mrs. Anderson did not state what she wanted but wrote in this letter how she could help them, focused on their wants, not on her wants. Thousands of salespeople are pound of pavement today, tired, discouraged and underpaid. Why? Because they are always thinking only for what they want. They don't realize that neither you nor I want to buy anything. If we did, we could go out and buy it. But both of us are internally interested in solving our problems. And if sales people can show us how their service and merchandise will help us solve our problems, they won't need us to sell. We will buy, and customer likes to feel that they are buying, not being sold. Yet many salespeople spend a lifetime in selling without seeing things from the customer's angle. For example, for many years I lived in Forest Hills, a little community of private homes in the center of Greater New York. One day I was rushing to the station and I changed to meet a real estate operator who had bought and sold property in the area for many years. He knew Forest Hills well, so I hurried, asked him whether or not my stucco house was built with a metal lathe and hollow tile. He said he did not know and told me what I already knew, that I could find out by calling the Forest Hills Garden Association. The following morning, I received a letter from him and did he gave me the information I wanted. He could give me gotten 60 seconds by the telephone call and he didn't. He told me again that I could not get it telephoning, then asked me to let me handle my insurance. He was not interested in helping me. He was interested only in helping himself. Tells how two people, salespeople from the same company, handle the same type of situation. Several years ago, I was on the managing team of a small company. Headquartered near us was a district office of large insurance company. Their agents were assigned territories and other companies are assigned to agents whom I call, refer to Carl and John. One morning, Carl dropped by our office and casually mentioned that his company has just introduced a new life insurance policy for executives. Thought he might be interested later on and he would get back to us when he wanted more information on it. The same day, John saw us on the sidewalk while returning from the coffee break and she shouted, "Hi Luke, hold up, I have some great news for you," follows. He heard over and very excitedly told us about the executive life insurance policy his company had introduced that very day. And he wanted us to one of first issued. He gave us a few minute important fact about the coverage and ended saying, "The policy is so new, I'm going to have someone from the home office come out tomorrow and explaining it. Now, in the meantime, let's get the application signed on the way so he can have more information to work with." His enthusiasm arose in his eager want for this policy, even though we still did not have details. When they were made available to us, they confirmed John's initial understanding of the policy. He not only sold each of us a policy, but later tripled our coverage. Carl could have these sales, but he made no efforts to arouse in us any desire for the policy. The world is full of people who are grabbing and self-seeking. So the rare individual who unselfishly tries to serve others has an enormous advantage and he has little competition. Owen D. Young, a note lawyer, one of America's greatest business leader, once said, "People who can put themselves in the place of other people, who can understand the working of their minds, need never worry about what the future has in store for them." If out of reading this book, you just get one thing, an increased tendency to think always in terms of other people's point of view and see things from their angles. If you get the one thing out of this book, it may easily prove that to be one building block of your career. Looking at the other person's point of view and arousing in him an eager want to something, not to be constructed as manipulated that person so that he will do something that is only for your benefit and detriment. Every party should gain from the negotiation. In the letter of Mr. Wellman, both the sender and the receiver of the correspondence gained by implementing what was suggested. Both the banks Miss Anderson won by her letter in that bank obtained a valuable employee, Mrs. Anderson, a suitable job. In the example of John Seals insurance to Mr. Lucas, both gained through the transaction. Another example in which everybody gains through this principle of arousing an eager want comes from Michael E. Widen or Warwick. Riardo Island, who has territory salesman of Shell Oil Company, and Mike wanted to make a number of one salesperson in his district, but one service station was holding him back, and it was run by older man who could not be motivated to clean up his station, and it was such poor shape that sales were declining significantly. This manager would not listen to anything Mike pitched to upgrade the station. After many exhaustion and heart-to-heart talks, all of which no impact, Mike decided to invite the manager to visit the newest Shell station in his territory. The manager was so impressed by the facilities as the newest station, and when the Mike visited him to the next time, his station was cleaned up and has recorded a sales increase. This enabled Mike to reach the number one spot in the district. All his talking and discussion had not helped but arousing an eager want in the manager by showing him the modern station. And he had accomplished his goal, and both the manager and Mike benefit. Most people go through college and learn to read Virgil and Master of Mysteries of Calcus without ever discovering how their own minds function. For instance, I once gave a course in effective speaking in the young college graduate who were entering to employ the Carrier Corporation, the large air conditioner manufacturer. One of the participants wanted to persuade the other pupils play basketball in the free time, and in this about what I wanted to came out of play basketball. I like to play basketball, but last times I have been gymnasium, there have not been enough people to get out the game. Two or three of us got throwing a ball around the other night, and I got a black eye, and I wish all you would come down tomorrow night. I want to play basketball. Did he talk about anything you want? You do not want to go to the gymnasium that no one else goes to, do you? You don't care about what he wants. You don't want to get a black eye. Would he have shown you have to get the things you wanted by gymnasium? Surely. More people, keener edge, appetite, clearly brain, fun, games, basketball. To repeat Professor Auer Strick's wise advice, first arouse in the other's person eager want, and he who can do this whole world with him, and he who cannot walks a lonely way. One of the students in the author's training course was worried about his little boy. The child was underweight and refused to eat properly. His parents used to usually method. They scolded, nagged. Mothers wants to eat this, that. Father wants to grow up to a big man. Did the boy pay any attention to these pleas? Just about as much as you pay on a flick of sand on a sandy beach. No one with a terrace of horse sense was expected a child 3 years old to react to the viewpoints of fathers 30 years old. Yet, that was precisely what the fathers had expected, and it was absurd. He finally saw that. So he said to himself, what does the boy want it? How can I tie up what I wanted to what he wants? It was easy for father when he started thinking about his boy. Had a tricycle that he loved to ride up and down the sidewalk of front of house in Brooklyn. A few doors down the street lived a bully, a bigger boy who would pull the little boy off his tricycle and ride in himself. Naturally, the little boy would run screaming to his mother, and she would have to come out and take a bull off tricycle and put her little boy on again. This happened almost every day. What did the little boy want? It did not take a Sherlock Holmes to answer that one. His pride, his anger, his desire for a feeling of importance, all the strongest emotion in his makeup, guided him to get revenge, to smash the bully in the nose. And when his father's example, that boy would be able to well up the daylights out of the bigger kid someday if he would only eat the things his mother wanted him to eat. And his father promised him that there is no longer any problem of dictates, the boy would have been eaten spinach, miracle, anything to order to the big enough to whip a bully who humiliated him so often. After solving the problem, the parents tackle another. The little boy has the little boy has un, unholy habit of wetting his bed, and he slapped his grandmother. In the morning, his grandmother would wake up and feel a sheet say, "Look, Johnny, what did you again last night?" He would say, "No, I did not do it. You do it." Scolding, spanning, shaming him, reiterating that parents did not want him to do it. None of these things kept the bed dry, so the parents asked, "How can we make this boy want to stop wetting his bed?" What was he want? First, he wanted to wear pajamas like dad asked, instead of wearing a nightgowns like grandmother. Grandmother was getting fed up in his nocturnal inquities, so he gladly offered to buy him a pair of pajamas if he would reform. Secondly, he wanted a bed of his own. Grandma did not object. His mother took him to a department store to Brooklyn and winkled a sales girl and said, "Here is a little gentleman who would like to do some shopping." The sales girl made him feel important by saying, "Young man, what can I show you?" He stood a couple of inches taller and said, "I wanted to buy a bed for myself." When he was shown the one of his mother wanted him to buy, he wrinkled at the sales girl and the boy persuaded to buy it. The bed was delivered to the next day. That night, when father came home, a little boy ran on the door shouting, "Daddy, daddy, come upstairs, see my bed I bought." Father, looking at the bed, obeyed Charles Squibb injection. He was heartily his abortion and lavish in his praise. "You are not going to wet this bed, are you?" The father said, "Oh no, no, I am not going to wet this bed." The boy kept his promise, for his pride and involved that was his bed, and he alone had bought it. And he was wearing pajamas now like a little man. He wanted to act like a man, and he did. Another father, Katie Dutchman, a telephone engineer, a student of this course, could not get a 3-year-old daughter to eat breakfast food. The usual scolding, pleading methods had all ended in futility. So the parents asked themselves, "How can we make her wanted to do it?" The little girl loved to imitate her mother to feel big, grown up, and so one morning they put their own chair and let her make the breakfast food. At just physiological moments, father drifted into the kitchen while she was stirring a cereal, and she said, "Oh, look, daddy, I am making a cereal in this morning." And she ate 2 helpings of cereal without any exuing because she was interested in it, and she had achieved a feeling of importance. William Winter once remarked, "Self-expression is dominant necessity of human nature." Why can't we adopt this same psychology to the business dealings? When we have a brilliant idea, instead of making other people it was ours, why not tell them and cook a stir a idea themselves? They will then regard it as their own. They will like it and make be eat a couple of helping of it. Remember, first arrows in the other person and eager want, and he who can do this has the whole world with him. He who cannot walk a lonely way. So the principle is about arrows in the other person and eager want. आई होप आपको ये वीडियो अच्छी लगी हो. लाइक करिए, सब्सक्राइब करिए.